everything that maybe you've seen of mine, because for my class, I'm going to talk about my work, everything you've seen of mine, 90% of all the paintings you've seen require several preliminary paintings, sketches and paintings. It's not just sit down and that's what happened. That rarely happens. Just like, I mean, how many people sit down at a typewriter or computer and just start typing, and when they're done, they hit enter, and the end, and it's a full novel. And it's finished. Nothing needs to be corrected. How many people do that? I don't know if they do that. Maybe there's three people on earth that do that. If they say to do that, I guarantee they'll lie. What does it take? Rough drafts, right? How can you create a masterpiece without rough drafts? I don't know. So how can we expect to do that with a painting? It's the same thing. How can we expect that? We can't expect that. Because if you're working rough draft and then you can take the thing and repaint it again, even if it's exactly the same thing, you're working out little bits of like things that are different. Okay, that part could be done maybe 5% better. This part could be done 2% better. Maybe if I move it over, maybe if I change the size, maybe if I add this color, maybe if I move this, it's becoming a better painting. Well, that's what we want, you know, why? Even though it could take 5 paintings and we've wasted how many weeks on 5 paintings just to get the one, and these don't mean anything. Throw them away. It's not wasted. So instead of like having 5 mediocre paintings, you have 1 masterpiece. Even though it took that much time, it's worth it. What, you know, in the long scheme of things in the history, what do we remember? When we look back in history and see the masterpieces, do we remember the 5 mediocre paintings? No one remembers any of that. That doesn't touch anybody. It doesn't help, you know. We watch a bad film, we forget it, never want to see it again, we do something else. We remember the masterpieces. So what if it takes 5 years to create 1 masterpiece, like the ultimate painting? Is it worth it? To me it is. It, you know, if somehow you could like work on 100 paintings and they all lead up to 1. To me that's worth it just because like, it shouldn't take that long, but. It's still an interesting idea anyways. So these are the things at least I'm trying to think about, and I hope that maybe if, I mean, you're probably already thinking this and you're just like, I already know this, shut up. But if you don't, maybe you think about it in a different way and maybe take a little extra time in the beginning. Just put a little thought into it, you know. The act of painting itself is so much fun. But not, the viewer doesn't necessarily, especially the uneducated viewer, doesn't actually appreciate the application of paint as much as you would think. That's for us artists to appreciate and enjoy. Like, the movie director would appreciate the way another movie director cut, you know, and edited and all this stuff, whereas we as viewers don't necessarily see that. So if you want to speak to a broader audience, which I think is important, it's not all about that, but if you want what you're saying to be viewed and understood by a broader audience, then it's not only about that beautiful thick brushstroke that look how it trails around. I mean, that's awesome. I love that. But not everyone appreciates that. So we need that and a great story to go along with it. I feel like most of us do this to share something or to change something or to put it out there. That's really what painting is. It's a visual thing for other people to see. The beautiful thing is this, though. This is one of the most exciting things about painting. It is the only universal language. Everybody who has eyes, you can speak to them. That's cool. You can't do that with verbal language. You can't even do that with music. You can do it with non-lyric, you know, music. But even so, there are some cultures that find that, that's a weird beat. I don't understand, you know. Even though, like, obviously you can see this as some people don't get it, but at the same time, it's, you can still say something to them without ever learning. So however many languages there are in the world, you can speak them by learning one, painting. That's cool. So your audience is however many billion people in the world now, 7 or something. That's pretty cool. I like that. Now, seeing as though this is a preliminary, a study, it's okay. That's the whole point of studies and preliminaries, is to figure out what you're doing. And it's like, with me, this is me working my way around what's happening. I try things, try other things. So this canvas in my studio would never be seen. I would never mean for people to see this one. actually like this better, but I'll stand up. Thinking about this, I'm gonna put my pants on. We stare at something for a while, it's almost as if we can't see it objectively anymore. So what do you do about that? You have to fight that by like being around it and then getting away from it and forgetting about it. Like, look up, I'm thinking, how do I feel about this? And if I catch myself staring too long, I need to look away and think about something else. Otherwise, I'm gonna lose that objective vision. If I lose that, then I don't know how you guys are seeing it. Of course, I'm assuming I know how you're seeing it, but I don't know how I would see it at my first glance, and that's how everyone else is gonna see it, like if you see it at first glance. I'm gonna keep that like early vision. The longer I look at something, I'm losing it as well. Fortunately, when you're setting something up, you have that early vision, and then once you decide on it, it's okay if you kind of lose it because you have to trust that when you did see it, it was okay. And then while you're painting, you've lost it, it's gone. You have no clue if it looks good anymore. But just copy it, and then it should look the same. Okay, let's shut off. As you're working with paint, the different brands do different things, and they have different consistencies, and sometimes this consistency works with this painting, and sometimes this one works for this color in this spot, so you just sort of get used to it. I use mostly all Rembrandt, but I have some other weird things too, like I'm using old lead white, because I like it, and Lefranc titanium white, because they're completely different.
What's your lead white?
You can use flake white or Kremnitz white. Every time you mix a color in 2 seconds, it adds up to 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. So I've spent half an hour on a painting just looking for color. We need half an hour. I need every spare second. So. That's that. I encourage that, anyways. You don't have to, you don't want to. I'm not learning as much. I'm not getting down live. I'm getting something that's just sort of still and stuck. So for me, it's a personal goal. Not really, I shouldn't say it's a goal to get faster, but it's a goal to be more efficient. Always more efficient. Like with anything else we do. Oil prime canvases. Raphael, Clausen's basically a good one, however you say that. They're good, I like them. My favorite? This one. This is a lead primed canvas. Actually this one, it's just the canvas, I don't actually know where the canvas is made, but it's on this panel made by the same company that makes this facade box. But it's like double or triple primed with white lead. The lead is just such a great surface. It's just fantastic. So
it's made by Edge?
Yeah, it's made by Edge, which makes the paint book that I'm using. I'm testing this out for them. This whole setup is going to be available for sale really soon. Custom glass or something. That you can clean everything. I like this because I can keep this really clean as opposed to other surfaces with this little razor.
Is it glass or plastic?
Yeah, it's a piece of tempered glass that you can use a razor blade that it comes with to scrape it off and keep it really nice and clean. And that's all about, I think that's the thing I like about this is that enables you to be organized and clean, which goes against the stereotypical painter. For some reason, we have this stereotype of just being messy people. Just like, that doesn't help anything. It doesn't help anything. You can have a crazy, chaotic, cool, dry brushy painting and do it in a very precise, clean way, in a surgical way almost, and be clean about it. Plus, you don't have to buy as many pairs of pants or shirts.
What?
The effects of you sell those.
That's true, that's true. That's what my paper towels are for.
You want to make some problems?
This is my special unicorn hairbrush. These are rare. We need the dreaded vibrant black. Nope, vibrant black. That's just kind of cool. And again, anybody has any questions or critiques or anything? Just shout them out. No, I'm just going to paint the background, actually. I'm sorry. I'm going to concentrate almost doing a landscape of a face. I want to capture this mood that she's got going on, a bit of her shoulder. Today, next time I'll do a bit more of a figure and stuff. This just inspires me. And I've already talked for who knows how long, so I don't have as much time as I would like. But that's the thing, you take that into account too. If you only have, some people are faster than others. I don't know, I just find that I want to get something done that looks a little more finished than a blocky sketch of a figure today. Well, I'm using a lot of mineral spirits and stuff just to block it in. Half the time, the painting is just putting paint on the canvas, blocking it in. Which is a faster way to do this.
Okay, what am I thinking right now? Lunch. No, I'm thinking about values. I am trying my values down first. To me, order of operation is value, then color, then edge, then drawing. Why do I say it that way? You gotta get paint on here before you can move it away. Paint with this much paint and get the drawing just right? Did you freaking touch it? You're like, I guess it's done, I don't want to do anything else to it. You start adding a little more paint, and you start worrying about drawing because you just got it right. So then you just start adding color, and then you mess your drawing up. So then you end up fixing your drawing at the end anyways. So I'm just doing it. I like to think of it as like a skull. Like you get your value on. Good paints. You get your color on after that, so you got the right color, it just looks like someone maybe punched in the face. But the value in the color, right on. As I'm cleaning my edges up, just move the shades ever so slightly until it's perfect. You're done. And it looks fresh and bold. And you know what I'm saying? Like, to me, in trying it all different ways, that's the way I've done it most efficiently, and I feel like it looks the strongest. It's not that I'm not thinking about drawing at all, obviously. I'm trying to get overall shape in the right spot. It's just that I'm not worried about it. I'm not just like, oh, I've got to get that eye shape just right now. You can easily move it around later. Not to mention, if you think about it that way, it gives you the freedom of not worrying about putting more paint on, just putting it on there. So I'm not worried about drawing. If you're not worried about drawing, then what does it matter? Put something somewhere. Just get some paint on. Start putting stuff on. Because I'm not worried about drawing. So you're fresh, you're bold. And once it's on there, it just takes the brushes and just sort of move it. And then it's right, you're finished. Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, in theory, that's the way it is. It doesn't have to be more complicated. Once in a while, it's time to take a clean, soft brush and just clean the edges up a little bit. Like this whole, there's a lot of this stuff that's just kind of messy, and I'm just kind of like soft, watch how I soft edge, just like soft edge. And it feels more like skin that way. Not necessarily what I would listen to in my studio, but.
What would you listen to?
Oh, you guys would hate what I listen to. I don't know, actually. I listen to a huge variety of stuff. Just everything from music to audiobooks to watch movies in the background. No, seriously, it's nice to catch up on your movie watching. Just have it like on. Watch the Mythbusters. Learn about exciting facts while you're painting. Yeah, I met him. I watched him paint. Shook his hand. We started a conversation. Of course, he thought I was an idiot and crazy for driving all the way up here. And let's see what happened. Oh, he invited me back to paint with him the weekend after that. So I drove back up the next weekend and painted with him. And that just kind of turned one thing led to another. We started talking over email. And, he started critiquing my paintings over email. And then over the phone. And then he invited me to go up and sort of live close by and study on a one-on-one basis for myself. So of course I did.
Yeah, you should have been crazy, huh?
Yeah. And that's how that worked. You know, and we still talk a lot, keep in contact and all that stuff. I mean, he's busy, I'm busy, we're both doing that thing, but it's just nice to sort of don't know. Like, I owe so much to him. So much.
So while you studied with him, since you have no aversion to black, and seemingly no aversion to raw umber or burnt umber,
yeah.
How did that come about?
When you learn from Richard and truly learn from him, you learn to be a little bit, he has a rebellious nature. His whole thing is, if there's a rule, I'm going to break it. Well, that's just what I did. I'm just breaking his rules. Okay. I'm not doing it because I'm doing it. It's just you learn to kind of not trust things. If there's the four easy steps to, or the thing not to ever do, well, why? Let me try and see why. And I'll be the judge of whether or not. Because there are no rules. Really. Yeah. What are the rules in painting? Well, that's not really a rule. What if I don't want my values to look right?
Oh, true.
See, yeah, there are no rules. There is no ultimate painting. There is no rule book to say you have to do this or it's not a good painting. And we have judges and critics, but that's just what they are. They're objective judges and critics, and what they ate for breakfast could determine whether or not they like the painting or not. But it doesn't mean it's a good painting or a bad painting. I've seen great paintings get first place. I've seen bad paintings get first place. What does that mean? That means that anything goes. If I put green right there or blue right there, does that make it a better painting or a worse painting? Whatever I think. You can go by popular opinion, but the popular opinion usually is, I don't like popular opinion. Take the whole world and say, who's their favorite painting? They're probably going to pull out some kind of
dogs
crazy
playing cards.
Yeah, seriously. And hey, that might be a decent painting, but it's not the best. I don't.
It goes a long way. It's hard to get thick paint when you have a lot of medium. I don't know. Like, all these big brushy strokes, I just feel like I would have to literally take my brush and scoop that entire pile of paint in order to do that instead.
Okay.
But I can add a little medium to it, and it thins it out and makes it a little washy. I use a mixture of the conserve-art varnish, and you can mix like the gloss and that, and I usually do about half and half.
Okay. How long do you have to wait before you varnish with that?
As long as possible. You know, they say different things, I don't know. I just wait right before I have to send to the gallery and varnish. Sometimes that's months, sometimes that's like 4 days.
Really? Wow.
I mean, I've waited a long time, and I've also not waited a long time, and I've never had any problem with anything, so they recommend you wait. You know, a lot of factors come into play here. It's like, it depends on the thickness of your paint, depends on what kind of paint you're using.
This Gambar says now that you can varnish as soon as the music airs.
Yeah.
As soon as it's dry to the touch, and it's supposedly
still breathes.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really what you're waiting on. You're really waiting on the paint to oxidize as much as possible so it doesn't break through. But you know, that technically a painting never dries. You know that? Never. It is constantly like moving and expanding, and it's really weird. So everything you do is like a huge leap. Like, whoa, look at that. It's sometimes, you know, it comes down to just tweaking. To his teacher, and his teacher basically, from what I hear, took a palette knife and just wiped down. And he said,
you can't do it again, then the first one's an accident. So we had to go back and repaint that whole area, which taught a valuable lesson. And that's totally true. If I'm fooling around here and I finally get it just right, but I don't really know how I did it, and if something happened, I feel like I could never get that again. Well, I don't want to live like that. That's an accident. That's not really me, it was an accident, you know. But if I know, like right now you take your thumb and just wipe it across there, I know, okay, well it's gonna take me a few more minutes, but I can get that again. That's power, okay? That's like freedom, and you get the feeling like, okay, you can try things, you can experiment, the model moves. It's not like, oh, my painting sucks, become the model. If it looks better, then how long did that take? I mean, that took a good, well, I don't know, 40 minutes, 30 minutes. But I like it better. It's not better than changing the model, but what I'm saying is you don't have that limited, I can only paint like this, I can only paint under cool light, I can only paint, you can paint anywhere, under any circumstances, with anything, and that's fun. That's really fun.